This tiny 5 feet by 5 feet kitchen is in my friend Alex's studio apartment. The minute I walked into this kitchen, I knew I wanted to take on the challenge to engineer this space. The tiny size and the fact that I couldn't paint or make any holes in the wall actually fueled my creativity. This is by far my most extreme and creative makeover that I've ever done. Before I begin, I want to thank the sponsor of this video, Citus. They make amazing coffee and coffee machines, so I was thrilled when they approached me to try their newest espresso coffee maker. I've never seen such a small and compact espresso coffee maker. It hardly takes up any counter space, so it's perfect for tiny kitchens. It's also very versatile because it works with both regular coffee grounds or pods, and you can even make a cup of tea with this machine. It's truly amazing how such a small and compact espresso machine can do all of these things. I'll be sharing more about how it works a bit later on in this video. This makeover all started with these black peel and stick subway tiles. I love using black to add drama to a space, and it fit perfectly with the industrial aesthetic I was going for in this kitchen. It might not be the obvious choice for a tiny space that's smaller than many closets and barely gets any sunlight. But I wanted to embrace those perceived limitations instead of fighting them, and use that to my advantage to create a warm, cozy, and enveloping space that is inviting to come in and spend some time in. I used high-end peel and stick tiles because they were a bit thicker, because it helps to hide the lines from the existing tiles underneath, especially where they're uneven. I love how these tiles are really easy to cut with a utility knife. It makes working around outlets and corners really easy. They are also easily removable and won't leave any residue on the tile. So this is perfect for a rental apartment like this where you can't make any permanent changes. I'll put a link to the specific tiles that I used in the video description below. This only took a few hours to do, and already the space has a lot more personality. This will be the perfect backdrop for all the changes to come. This kitchen has very little counter space and no dishwasher. So it made sense to me to use the space above the sink as a dish drying rack. There's lots of options for wall-mounted dish racks, but none of them were the right dimensions, and all of them required making holes in the wall. It was seeing these bamboo dish racks that actually gave me the idea to MacGyver my own that would be exactly the same size as the existing shelf. This project turned out to be a true Frankenstein. I used wood scraps that I had on hand to make the frame. I used dowels that I had from another project, and I also recycled parts of an old bamboo shade. All of that came together to create a functional dish drying rack that frees up counter space and also brings in warm wood tones. That's a nice contrast to the black tiles and the white cabinets. The original plan for the back wall was to make it a feature by making it all black with removable peel and stick wallpaper. Unfortunately, the wall was way too textured and damaged for that to look good. Then I got the crazy idea to cover the entire wall with half-inch plywood, paint that black, and then take advantage of the fact that it's a tiny kitchen and put in a tension rod to wedge the plywood against the wall. Luckily, my crazy idea worked because it was a lot of work to make this into a reality. From cutting the plywood to go around the countertops and the window, sanding, painting, and I had to cut so many pieces of 1/4-inch plywood. I had to do that because of the molding at the bottom of the wall, which was preventing the panel from sitting flat against the wall. So I glued strips of that 1/4-inch plywood around the edges of the top and sides of the panel. Not difficult to do, just very time consuming. With the first panel done, I got to work on the second one. It was such a happy moment when it finally fit in place. All that hard work paying off. As I was admiring my handiwork, I realized that I liked the contrast of the wood texture against the black tiles and the black panel. So I decided to keep it as is and just protect it with some wood stain that brings out the rich wood tones and pattern. I'm so glad that I didn't paint the second panel black. I really like the asymmetry and shapes created by the different colors and the window. Let me know what you think in the comments. Would you have kept everything black or do you like the two-tone? To finish off this feature wall, I added a 1x3 at the top, which hides the gap between the panels and the ceiling and also connects the two panels together. The window valance also helps to keep the panels flush against the wall, along with this piece of molding that covers the gap between the two panels along the middle. The last piece of the puzzle for this feature wall was to add shelves. I cut them so that they fit snugly between the cabinets and the plywood to keep the plywood pressed against the wall. The nice thing about having this plywood is that you can screw into it without having to put any holes in the actual wall. Every single cubic inch of this tiny nook was used to create this gourmet coffee station. The only thing missing was an espresso machine, and this one from Citus actually couldn't be more perfect. The Citus 4-in-1 instant heating espresso machine is extremely compact and hardly takes up any counter space. The stand and the body of the machine also come apart, so it makes it extremely easy to store anywhere, which is a great feature for small spaces. This tiny machine can also make coffee or tea and works with coffee grounds or pods. And these extraction chambers are the key to this versatility. The G chamber is for coffee grounds or tea, the D chamber is for dulce gusto pods, and the N chamber is for Nespresso pods or its knockoffs. When it comes to making coffee in the morning, I like to keep things very simple, and I don't like complicated machines with all kinds of buttons and settings. Making a shot of espresso with the Citus 4-in-1 espresso machine is really simple. You put the coffee grounds or pods in the appropriate chamber. You load that into the machine. You add water in the external water tank on top of the machine. You pull down the lever, which locks in place the chamber. And then all that's left is to press a button to choose what amount of coffee you want. The biggest cup is 160 milliliters, and the smallest one is 45 milliliters. Once you press the button, it only takes a few seconds to heat up the water to the perfect temperature. The 19 bar pump extracts a rich, smooth espresso very quietly, and in no time at all, you're ready to enjoy your espresso. If you're interested in getting one for your kitchen, you can find out more on the Citus website, which I'll link in the video description below. Now back to the makeover. This is already a pretty dramatic transformation. It's hard to believe that it's the same space, but I'm not done yet. This old worn-out faucet was standing out like a sore thumb. Luckily, the landlord gave us his blessing to replace it. It's actually something very easy to do, and I actually did that in my own apartment as well. I made a detailed video of all the steps to change a faucet, so if you're looking for that information, I'll put a link in the description below. This faucet was so old that the rubber gasket had completely disintegrated. It was so satisfying to scrub everything clean and remove all that grime. The old faucet had a soap dispenser, but instead of replacing that, I chose a new faucet that has a sprayer, which will be much more useful, especially for rinsing things out and cleaning the sink. This new faucet is quite an upgrade in style and function. The next project was to maximize the space in the cabinet below the sink with the Simply Human pull-out trash and recycling bins. These are typically secured directly to the bottom of the cabinets, but because this is a rental apartment, I couldn't do that. So my workaround was to secure the frame of the bins onto a piece of plywood that is a few inches longer than the actual frame. The double-sided tape helps to prevent the plywood from moving side to side, but what really keeps it in place is this tension rod that I wedged between the piece of plywood at the bottom and the top of the cabinet. The pressure from the tension rod holds down the plywood, making it possible to pull the bins in and out without any issues. Next, I turned my attention to the mini fridge. I wanted it to disappear and really blend in, so I decided to cover it with a matte black contact paper. This is a very easy project to do. You just need to be very patient and take your time. I did this very slowly, moving back and forth, pushing down the contact paper, small increments at a time. I found that that was the best method to avoid getting air bubbles. It's a really small detail, but I'm really glad I did it because now the fridge really fits into the rest of the kitchen with all the black, and it kind of just recesses and disappears. Changing out the knobs on kitchen cabinets is another small detail that can make a big impact. I went to the hardware store to take a look at some options and also to test out how they feel when pulling on them. We tend to just focus on how they look, but it's something that gets used every single day. So the knobs should not only look good, but also feel good. I really like the square knobs the best and ended up finding the perfect ones on Amazon. They were less expensive and the distressed metallic finish was the perfect thing to go with that industrial rustic vibe. If you've seen any of my previous kitchen makeovers, you know that I love to add LED under cabinet lighting, and this kitchen is no exception. The flexible LED lights that I chose had an adhesive backing that wasn't quite strong enough to hold them in place. So I added some removable double-sided tape to fix that. Another bonus of doing this is that it will make it easier to remove when it's time to move out. I also added black flexible tubing to hide the wires. They will go from one end of the cabinets up across above the dish rack and down again under the back cabinet. To hide the light strip above the dish rack, I added a piece of molding which covers the lights nicely but also allows the light to shine down. These lights add much needed task lighting, and because I chose lights that mimic daylight, they brighten up the room with a natural glow without having to turn on the ceiling lights during daytime. With this kitchen only being 25 square feet, I had to squeeze out as much storage as possible. So taking advantage of all the vertical space available was key. I made the most of this back wall by adding some racks and shelves, and it was really nice to have the plywood to attach everything to without having to make any holes in the actual wall. I also removed the tiny corner shelf to make room for a magnetic knife rack. Luckily, the shelf supports were only screwed in, so they were really easy to remove. To avoid making any new holes in the wall, I attached the knife rack to a piece of wood and then attached the piece of wood to the wall with the holes lining up perfectly with the existing holes. This knife rack here will be much more useful than that shelf because this is where all the cooking and food prep is going to be happening. Another addition to the kitchen was this wire shelving under the counter to store an oven and also large pots and cookware. Adding a backsplash above the counter on the right side of the kitchen wasn't in the original plan, but after I did this test, I liked how it looked with the tile much better. The challenge is that the wall texture made the tiles have lots of dimples. So my solution was to use a piece of 1/4 inch thick plywood to cover the wall to make a smooth surface for the tiles. I didn't want to use 3M command strips because they are very thick and it would have made that piece of plywood stick out of the wall too much. Instead, I used these thin Velcro strips that are also removable. I'll put a link to the Velcro strips in the description below. Also here, since this is where the hot plate is going to be used for cooking, I added an aluminum plate to protect the tiles from the heat and cooking splatter. I'm really glad I decided to put the tile on the right side, but let me know in the comments what you would have done. Would you have left the wall white or would you have put the tiles? Now I thought that this was going to be it for this makeover, but now with all of these changes, those pink floor tiles just didn't go with the rest of the room at all. After a quick search online, I found these loose lay vinyl planks that you can lay over an existing floor without using any glue or hardware. I wasn't sure how well these would work with the existing tiles. And they were a bit pricey, but since it's such a tiny kitchen, all I needed was one box and I just had to give it a try. All you need to cut the tiles is a utility knife and a straight edge. I just scored the vinyl plank a few times, then I bent the plank along the score line to make it snap, and I used my utility knife again to separate the pieces completely. The tricky part was making the corner cuts around the door frame and the walls. Using a template was definitely necessary and useful to get the right shape to cut out. I did find it more difficult to bend the small pieces, but I just used my utility knife to gouge deeper and deeper into the cut, and I was able to cut out the shape. I was pleasantly surprised with how well the tiles stayed in place and how flat they actually laid on the existing floor tiles. Very happy with this experiment and how it turned out. It was a lot of fun to come up with ways to give it an industrial yet rustic vibe, all without actually making any permanent changes. But it's all the added functionality that was a true game changer for this space. It's easy to stay focused on just how a space looks, but unless it's actually functional and practical for day-to-day living, it won't feel good to spend time in there. And that's especially true of small spaces. You want everything to be within easy reach when you need it. You don't want to have to rummage to find things. There's a certain effortless flow to this kitchen now that makes it really pleasant and fun to be there, to cook, and to just hang out and relax. You might think that it's a bit extreme to do all of this work for a rental apartment. However, my hope is that by pushing the envelope and showing you what's possible, I can inspire you to engineer your space into a home you love and are proud of. Well, that's it for this makeover, but before I go, I want to say a special thank you to Situs for making this video possible. I really enjoy trying out their 4-in-1 espresso machine. It's very simple to use, and I love that it can make both coffee and tea, and that it can be used with coffee grounds or pods. If you're in the market for a compact espresso machine that makes amazing coffee and that's really easy to use, it's worth checking this one out. I'll put a link to the Situs website in the video description below so you can click on it to find out more. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.